Christ. At the end of each pew is a registration book. Would you please sign that and pass it on down? There's a welcome center outside the sanctuary.
I'll find you.
Guest register, sign contact information, and a gift back to welcome you to Western Hills United Methodist Church. We have some announcements this morning.
But I can only think of two right now. One of them is, next week, next Sunday is your last Sunday to bring school supplies. And that's for BBS. And so if you haven't brought some, please do. If you feel like you could be moved to bring another set, that would be wonderful too. And it's three things, 24 pack of Crayolas, a pack of notebook paper, water ruled, and pencils in a pack. So then you still have until the 9th of July, so you have a couple more Sundays after BBS, to bring paper goods for the United Community Centers. So please, and remember the action now for a different level. Yes, if you are interested in getting a name tag, either because you haven't had one before from here, or because you've lost or misplaced yours, meet me in the Narthex. I went off without the pads, but I'll find something to write down your name and what kind of name tag you want. Whether you want the clip or the magnet. And I don't mind telling you, my bias is toward the magnet. It won't poke holes in your clothing. And if you want to make a donation toward the name tag fund, we would appreciate that. Thank you.
Good morning. Couple things. First off, youth today, our activity is going to be skating. So we are meeting at Rollerland West at 2 o'clock and then coming back here to eat at 5. And we don't have anybody signed up for dinner tonight. So if anybody wants to bring in dinner, that'd be great. If not, we'll take care of that and have pizza. But we are meeting at Rollerland West at 2. If there's any youth that are needing a ride, let us know. And or if you're needing a ride back, also parents will ensure that. Secondly, if you have not filled out your packet for BBS or done the Ministry Safe program and you're helping with it, we really need those taken care of. Those of you that are in the skits, hopefully I've talked to each of you individually, but if you're in the skits, we are meeting at 6:30 Wednesday night to run through the remote vehicle. The rest of you that are helping with BBS, we're going to come up Monday evening and just kind of make sure that everything is in place and go through everything. So Monday night at 6 o'clock and then registration on the 18th and then registration at 5:30 will begin on the 19th for the 19th, 20th, and 21st for BBS. So it's going to be a lot of fun, and everybody that can help, let me know. Thank you.
There are some other activities and announcements on things that are happening for the rest of the week on the back of the bulletin. A couple of them I just noticed there's a welcoming committee meeting scheduled for Tuesday evening at 7 o'clock. There's also an Alzheimer's support group meeting on Thursday evening at 7 o'clock. But the other opportunities are on the back of the bulletin. I think that's all the announcements. Thank you. in the congregational greeting. The grace of Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Spirit.
God holds us fast in love, so fast we can never outrun it. Let us live in the confidence of this heavenly love.
Thank you.
Would you please join me in the prayer of illumination as we pray? Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. The first reading is from the New Testament, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 13, chapter 5, verse 1. But just as we have the same spirit of faith that is in accordance with Scripture, I believed and so I spoke. We also believe and so we speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and will bring us with you into his presence. Yes, everything is for your sake, so that grace, as it extends to more and more people, may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart, even though our outer nature is wasting away. Our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure. Because we look not at what can be seen, but at what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. The word of God to the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Guilty of an eternal sin. For they have said he is an unclean. Then his mothers and brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, "Your mother and your brothers and sisters are outside asking for you." And he replied, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" And looking at those who sit around him, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the work of God is my brother and sister and mother." Hear the word of the Lord. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. You may be seated. Jesus picks 12 disciples, and he decides what the ministry is going to be about. Tells his disciples, "They off they go. They healed the sick. They cast out demons. They did miracles." And the crowds were big. Always big. Let's face it, you hear somebody say, "I can heal you," or "He had healed so and so," I'm going to head that way if I have something to be healed. So the crowds became big and bigger. And Jesus decided, "I must go home and recuperate." And now while we come home, get our breath, to recuperate. So off he goes, back home. But he came from a little village. He's known as what? The carpenter's son. Joseph the carpenter's son. Nobody knew that he was God's son, sent to save us all. So he gets closer, and the controversies of him healing and committing miracles and doing all these godly things caused more controversy and controversy. And they got back to the small town. And mom and dad was hearing all these rumors. "Oh, did you hear what he did? Oh, that's, oh, he is going again. God, he's blaspheming God." And the closer and closer we got, well, what would mom want to do? If you had a child that was being pushed and hated and push. What would you want, mom? Dad? You would want to protect him, wouldn't you? I have to protect my son. Obviously, by this time, since Joseph had never been mentioned, that he had probably already passed away. So all that was left was mom and the brothers, sisters. So what did they do? "Oh, we'll go meet him and we'll usher him off and bring him home and we won't let anybody see him." So here they go, off they go. And while they're in this mood to save this son and brother, what happens? The scribes, the religious leaders, decided we need to do something about this blasphemy of God. So off they went from Jerusalem. And they come up with this saying, how he must be devil's or Satan's group, part of that ruling class that demons listen to, because he's casting out demons. That can't be right. It's either God's doing it or Satan doing it. So Jesus hears this, and the scribes approach him. And what does he do? He says, how can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, a kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. Have you heard them words before? I'm from a small, not a small town. I'm from a town called Quincy, Illinois. I was raised in Quincy, Illinois. One of the Douglas Lincoln debates was in that town. So of course, in both towns, we celebrate all our important events. And since Abraham Lincoln has ended up being president, we had to celebrate a Lincoln and Douglas debate. I misled my Sunday school class this morning because I told him I thought it was from Gettysburg Address, but it's not. It's from the Douglas Lincoln debate in Quincy. And what he said was, when he hit words, a house divided from itself cannot stand. Does that sound familiar? And then when we read scripture here, in Mark, it says, a house divided against itself will not be able to stand. Well, I would guess Abraham Lincoln got that from the scriptures. At some time in his life, in Sunday school maybe, or in a worship service, he heard these words and thought, this is so important that we need to listen to them. And he included that in his Douglas Lincoln debate. Jerry gave me a good illustration this morning that I hadn't thought of. And I'm going to use it. So I'm giving it. The ditto is from Jerry. Think, Mom and Dad, about your children, teenager, whatever. And they come to you, like mine have many times, and said, Dad, Mom, can I go to the show with some friends? And they do this separately, because they know if one doesn't give the correct answer, maybe the other one will. Remember that, Mom and Dad? You remember that thing? Mom says, no, and they haven't made your choice. Okay. Mom says, no, I'm going to sneak over to Dad and see if I can get him changed. So he goes over to Dad, or she goes over to Dad and says, Dad, I need to go with my friends to the show. It's the last show at the show. And Dad says, oh yeah, go. Oh man, I can't tell you how many times this situation worked out in my family. I had four kids, and it wasn't failing that each one of them tried this. What happens to a family when Mom says something and Dad says something else? The kids don't get any problems, but there is a little tension between Mom and Dad. Can you see where the scripture's going? If Satan really was casting out demons, he was dividing his power on his demons, right? There's no way Satan would have said, now, you put this spell on this person. You do your thing, make that worse. And then over here he says, well, then you go ahead and take it off, Jesus. Ain't that, And Jesus says, are you kidding me? Why would you do that, Satan? Or why would you do that, Hebrew scribes who wanted to attack Jesus? So, of course, that was what Jesus used. And if Satan had risen up against himself and had divided, he cannot stand, but his end had come. It would have been the end of Satan. Just like if this continues in the family, it's usually the end of the family. But truly I tell you, people will be forgiven for the sins, whatever blasphemy they utter. But whoever blasphemies against the Holy Spirit can never have forgiveness, but is guilty of eternal sin. I want you to keep these scribes in your mind when they accuse Jesus of being part of Satan, part of the devil, the evil side of life. Think about that. We live as Christians, as believers, because God, through Jesus Christ, will forgive us if we repent. That means if you commit murder and you repent, God will forgive you. If you commit adultery and you repent, God will forgive you. If you worship idols or, in our term and language, wealth, power, and you repent, God will forgive you. So what is forgivable sin? What is the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? I guess the question will be, how do you define the Holy Spirit? Who or what is the Holy Spirit? Did you ever think about that? We know God sent the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, when I go, well, I can't. God the Father can't send the Holy Spirit unless I go, and he will be an advocate for you. Jesus defines the Holy Spirit to us. He will be an advocate for you. The Holy Spirit is God the Father, God the Son, living with and within us today. That's what the Holy Spirit is. The Holy Spirit is God. And you have these Hebrews, religious leaders, denying God when they say, Jesus, you are part of Satan's demon. They were denying God when they did not recognize the power of the Holy Spirit. So how do we do that? Or do we? We as Christians live with the understanding of the Trinity. God God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. When we think of the Holy Spirit, we need to think in the context where God has given it. That Holy Spirit is God the Father, Jesus Christ, God the Son, and also our advocate, the Holy Spirit, who lives with us and takes care of us, the advocate, who guides and brings us together.
Family is made up of people who care about each other,
that love each other, that support each other, that will do whatever it takes for that family to get to move forward in life. The family is more than the person who is watching into life. The people you played with when you were young. The person you called brother or sister or mom or dad. The family is all these things that Christ has given us. Love each other, support each other, encourage each other. What am I describing here? Isn't that the church? Isn't that God's kingdom? The families, each one of you, Mike put it there, it's excellent. When you looked around them kids, we are all part of that family. That is what Christ was trying to do. He was trying to preserve the family. What would you do to preserve the family? What would it take for you to stand up and say, this is my family? Maybe different, maybe a different culture, maybe have a lot of different things about it, because they are my family. I've been on several mission trips, and in Bolivia and Kenya, and one thing you realize when you go on these mission trips, not just the people that go with you, the missionaries that go with you, but the people that you are involved with, you're not there to help them. They're there to help you as much as you are to give them. They are your family. When I was in Bolivia, our Indians had a dialect themselves. But let me tell you one thing. When they sang Amazing Grace, we sang along, although we didn't understand the language, we knew what they were singing. It was a common connection as family. And they wasn't after worship service, their worship services last several hours or half a day. Because after the worship service, they don't all go home and fix lunch. They all go to a central place and they share lunch. That's the first time I had ever eaten purple potatoes. And it takes a little time to get used to that. That's what we're supposed to be here, the rest of the Hills United Methodist Church. We are the family of God. Each one of us are part, no matter what we call ourselves, what name we have, we are all part of the same family. And that's what God wants from us, to be a loving, supporting, and always be together. So remember, the family of God is not a building. The family of God is you.
love the child to right,
for righteousness
and the life everlasting.
Heavenly Father, we come to you in this humble way, knowing that through your Holy Spirit, the names we have lifted up, the situations and the families, that your will be done in their lives. Help us, Lord, to be your hands and feet as we go forth in your grace to do your ministry, that we who we come in contact with show your love that you have given us. Give us our truth and love that because we believe in your Son Jesus Christ, that we are being advocated of our own shortnesses in life. And we know, Lord, as we bring them to you, Now we come to you, God, and we join in unison prayer that your Son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the
Thank you.
come, we have worship, we have praise and glorify God. Go forth as a family of God, in love with each other, to give that gift of love to others. Go into God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.